primeval forests felling, we the rivers stemming, vexing we, and piercing deep the minds within. We the surface broad surveying, we the virgin soil upheaving, pioneers. Oh, pioneers.
Nation of Sodbusters, of pioneers who took on the job of changing the wild world to the uses of man, and who succeeded. In six short generations, we have taken and tamed the continent. We've taken timber and iron, air and water, land and the land's harvest, and we've taken a lot for granted. Today we face an environmental crisis and we wonder, where have we been? What have we done? What can we do? The date, September 16th, 1893. The event, the last great land rush. 6 million acres of land known as the Cherokee Strip. Now part of the Oklahoma Panhandle. The end of an era. The last crest of the wave of white men that swept the American continent. Hunger for land was the driving force of the pioneer. Homes for the homeless. The land of opportunity. Dollar land.
The word bonanza has been adopted as a symbol of the frontier spirit. I think it's an appropriate one. You know, in the very early days when America was still a dream, people thought of the New World as a land of gold, essentially, a place where you could go and pick up riches, as you will. When we came here, the reality was somewhat different, but still there was an opportunity to exploit and to grab what you could for yourself. So that the sense that there were riches here persisted, both in fact, but more importantly, I think, in the kind of dream. There was always another horizon. There was always another place where that pot of gold might still lurk, and if you were strong enough, courageous enough, you could find it.
In 1845, John L. O'Sullivan, editor of the New York Morning News, summed up the American attitude toward the West.
It is our manifest destiny to overspread and to possess the whole of the continent which Providence has given us.
Another New York editor reflected the same public mood.
There is, in fact, no such thing as title to the wild lands of the New World, except that which actual possession gives. They belong to whomever will redeem them from the Indian and the desert and subjugate them to the uses of man.
I'm not sure that I would call the attitude of pioneer belligerent toward nature. It certainly was an attitude of conquest in the sense that he wanted to dominate and extract the wealth from the nature that he saw. If any other creatures got in his way, including Indians, he was not too anxious to respect their rights.
Yesterday Show with your host, Tommy Parson. Tommy's guests tonight include cowboy star Jack Grab, environmentalist Robert Trashman, well-known industrialist Mr. C. Steele Mills, and that queen of consumers, Betty Byer. And now, here's Tommy.
To a big start with an old friend of mine, an expert on the Old West. You've probably seen him starring in his new film, How the West Was Bought. Let me present Mr. Jack Grab. Jack, come on out here. Jack, I understand that your film is doing quite well.
Yeah,
and we're going to run a film clip of it, and while we're showing it, would you tell us what it's about?
All right, Tommy. Now, this here movie's a typical American success story. You might call it a saga of free enterprise. Now, there, that's me on the horse there going lickety-split.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in it, I play Ben Farright, owner of the biggest spread in the West, the Squanderosa.
Mm-hmm. Well, I saw the film at a screening, and I wonder, how did you manage to make that buffalo hunting scene so realistic?
Well, we use real buffalo and live ammunition. I wanted that scene to be perfect.
You actually killed the buffalo you used in the film.
Right. But we didn't use American buffalo.
Oh, you didn't?
No. We brought in some Asian water buffalo and dressed them up in chub coats. Furry chub coats.
Oh!
Shot them, yeah.
Well, then I guess it's all right. You know, with all the talk about ecology today, a lot of people are really touchy about killing animals. But speaking of ecology, you're doing something about it, I understand. A project to preserve the beauty of our national parks.
No, I'm not.
The first bonanza was fur. In 1820, the Pacific Northwest was teeming with beaver, bear, and other fur-bearing animals. 20 years later, 1840, the Rockies and surrounding areas were trapped out.
The game's all driven out. There's no place here for a white man now. It's too poor. A white man has no more business here.
Many fortunes were made in fur, notably those of the American Fur Company, founded on the business genius of John Jacob Astor. In 1834, Astor's company began offering Indians a rifle and ammunition in exchange for 11 buffalo hides. Indians thus became the first commercial buffalo hunters. When the famous British explorer, Sir Richard Burton, crossed the American plains in 1860, there still remained 7 million buffalo roaming wild.
The annual destruction is variously computed at 200,000 to 300,000 head. The American Fur Company received per annum about 70,000 droves, and not more than 5,000 of these fall by the hand of the white man.
By 1883, 10,000 buffalo remained. They were slaughtered that year.
The conditions of the 19th century were those in which exploitation, particularly in a new country like America, was, in a sense, the thing to do. I mean, it was what historical conditions called for at that time. It did not necessarily have to be done with a kind of brutality and single-mindedness that, in fact, it was done with. To cut trees and then move on, to plow the land and move on, to spare human beings labor and to substitute for that labor a maximum use of these nearly free and apparently inexhaustible resources.
We primeval forests felling. And piercing deep the minds within.
Arizona, New Mexico, Utah, and Colorado meet in an area called Four Corners. Here, six huge fossil fuel power plants are under construction, in operation, or being planned. Much of the coal they burn comes out of strip mines like the one at Black Mesa, Arizona, which produces at a rate of 500 tons per hour. Airborne pollutants shower the surrounding area. For example, the Four Corners plant at Fruitland, New Mexico, which generates power for Los Angeles, belches out airborne particulates at a rate of 55 tons per day, sulfur dioxide at 237 tons per day, nitrogen oxides at 240 tons per day. Technology does not exist to reduce sulfur dioxide or nitrogen oxide emissions significantly in the near future. Here in microcosm is the environmental cost of most power generation. Disruption of the earth, resource depletion, pollution. In spite of this, the USA continues to be the first of the big spenders of power. Only 6% of the world's people, we consume 35% of the energy. And the more you use, the less it costs, thus promoting excessive consumption, especially by large industrial users.
You know, one of the things that people need to learn about the environment is that it represents a constraint on what we can do. When we look at these curves of the growth of electric power, the power companies and many other people say, well, we've got to keep on.
There are, on the horizon, and in pretty good shape in terms of research, some very exciting and promising means of reducing the effect of making power on the environment, and thereby negating Mr. Commoner's equation of incremental degradation for incremental power.
The reason why our electric power consumption keeps going up exponentially is that so far it hasn't been coupled to the dwindling source of fuel and to the rapidly rising impact on the environment.
But we can get down to levels that are certainly tolerable, that will not further degrade the environment. The nuclear route to us has seemed to be the most promising of all, because we eliminate fumes and dusts and gases. The amount of radionuclides that are emitted to the atmosphere is so minuscule as to be almost negligible.
There's no such thing as non-polluting power, because any power, even if it caused no radiation, as in the case of nuclear power, or chemical pollution, as in the case of the burning of fossil fuel, all power ends up as heat. When we put out new products, like a self-cleaning oven, which increases the amount of electricity used per good received. After all, the good of an oven is that it cooks things. When we avoid the necessity to clean the oven by pouring a lot of electricity into it to heat it up and burn out the dirt, what we're doing is transferring that dirt, so to speak, somewhere else in the environment. We're trading off the problem of washing the oven for dirtying the air. The Navajo Indians at Black Mesa in the Southwest are having their air polluted in order to produce power that the people of Los Angeles consume. That's the kind of trade-off that's involved everywhere.
Subject of ecology, let me bring out my next guest. He's environmentalist Robert Trashman. Well, Bob, welcome to the show. Tommy, I'm just here to point out some of the damage that we've been doing to the environment. I'd like you to take a look at this fish here, Tommy. This fish comes from one of the most polluted streams in the United States. The water was so bad that this fish couldn't live in it.
That fish was actually killed by pollution?
Well, not directly, Tommy. You see, the fish crawled out of the water and was hit by a car. If that water was clean, this fish never would have crawled out.
I guess you think the water's cleaner in Russia?
What does that have to do with it? I'm talking about poisoning ourselves.
Well, I'd rather poison myself than live under a commie dictator.
I certainly do think that both in terms of the experience of the nation and of individuals, that having come up through the hard knock school, you tend to persist in the attitudes that that created. So that America, having been through the frontier syndrome, through the frontier experience, retains those attitudes, just as individuals who have had to work very hard for a living tend, even when they become very wealthy, to retain many of the attitudes that they that were appropriate to their early struggles.
America was the refuge of the tired, the homeless masses, the have-nots from other lands. The quick money men skimmed off the fur, gold, and timber. But most pioneers came to stay on land they could call their own. To have it, to hold it, to farm it. They faced extraordinary hardships. In 1859, 30,000 settlers gave up on Kansas when a drought wiped out their crops. Hardships were many. They were endured for a reason. For a better tomorrow. For a proper house later. To be worth something. Material progress was an understandable preoccupation. For settlers who stuck it out, there were many potential rewards. Gradually, towns sprang up. Many a man grew rich as civilization followed and his land became more valuable. Growth was an undeniable good. More people meant more markets and more money.
Behavior patterns learned in one circumstance always tend to persist after long after the circumstances change, and so that the change from the 19th century essentially is a reversal now. We have an abundance of people, an abundance of labor, and a growing scarcity, at least of cheap natural resources. But the attitudes that prevail in the 19th century when the reverse was true do persist.
Why don't I bring up my next guest now? I'm sure he can shed some light on the subject of ecology. He's industrialist C. Steel Mills. Mr. Mills, come on out here. Mr. Mills, how do you feel about the fact that most people blame industry for all the troubles in our environment?
Well, environment, environment, environment. How many times have we heard that tiresome phrase, Tommy? I'd like to say that we will try to build a non-polluting automobile, but at the same time, we'd like to see medical science come up with a better human respiratory system.
That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. You people make useless products and then try to convince us that we need them. Just take a look at this fish.
We like to think of it as the freedom to want. Surely we all want something, don't we? New cars, color television sets, toasters. What America wants, America gets because American industry stands ready to give it to America.
That's the most inspiring thing I ever heard in my whole life. That's ridiculous. Baloney. If we weren't on the air, I'd tell you what was in baloney. Take a look at this fish.
You and that damn fish. Why don't you send that fish back to Moscow and send yourself with it?
I hope Mr. Trashman isn't suggesting we limit production or hold back progress. Surely every company, like our frontier forefathers, has the right to grow, expand, and profit.
Of course, is a leader. We will be expanding constantly as long as there is a population expansion. As far as our country going to a zero population growth, our country really has many, many vast areas of land that there are no people in, so there's not a problem if our growth would exceed the possibilities. Of course, that's impossible, because as long as man lives, he will be looking for more better ways of doing what he is doing, but we can always branch out, just like Columbus did under to America. We can always branch out to other planets. There is a lot of research doing here. Our company, or our country, excuse me, I'm speed oriented. Our country is undoubtedly the greatest company in the country in the world, and I'm just very, very happy, and have to thank God that I'm a part of it. I have a piece of blank paper that I start every morning off with and have my goal on the top of the paper, and then I run, they call it Ben Franklin's balance sheet, and run different ways that I can attain this goal, new ideas. I would say a self-made man is a man that has reached his goals. I want enough money that I can live and do the things that I want, when I want, without barriers. As far as saying an exact sum, that's hard to say. It's hard to say. It would probably be infinite. I doubt if anybody ever has too much. Lincoln Continental, I'm in love with the car. I like the car. I am, of course, conveying a image of success. People like to look successful, and of course, that's how people judge each other, right? Many people in my business that are making great sums of money, if you're talking about making $100,000 a year, people just expect that you're going to be driving this kind of car.
Why don't I bring out my last guest now, a woman recently selected as Consumer of the Year, Mrs. Betty Byer.
Hello. I'll take what's behind curtain number three.
We don't have a curtain number
three.
Well,
I'll take what's in the box then.
We don't have a box either.
So what do I win?
Nothing. We just want to talk to you, Betty.
Listen, talk's cheap and time's money. Now, I can't go home empty-handed, right? Hey, that's a nice watch.
How were you selected as Consumer of the Year?
Well, actually, you know, I spent a higher percentage of my husband's income than any other housewife in America.
Oh, well, what percentage?
250%.
Amazing.
Yeah. Well, it's great to live in a country with easy credit terms. You know what I mean? I mean, where would we be if our ancestors didn't trade in their cars every year? Right, Mills? You know what I'm talking about, don't you?
I think that's ridiculous.
What do you know?
That's disgusting.
Oh, yeah?
Why don't you show her your fish?
All right, look at this fish.
Feel opposite of the television.
Make a look at this.
Hey, what about my cutaway knife?
What about my fish?
The environmental crisis represents a huge debt that we've run up against nature by destroying the environmental systems that support us and everything we do. Now that debt has to be paid, and we pay through the economic system. Our economy is based on extracting goods for private use, profit. The environment, in fact all of our resources, are a social good.
As a nation, we have a lot of bad habits. We have super-duper gas-gulping auto engines, self-cleaning ovens, and self-propelling gizmos of all kinds. We guzzle electricity and promote its excessive use by rates that charge less the more you buy, even though making electric power depletes our resources and pollutes our air. Lincoln Mercury takes. Our way of life grew out of the frontier, which had many resources and few people. Resources once seemed limitless, and their excessive use is built into our way of life today.
Personal luxury. From any angle, the town car.
We face increasing numbers of people, dwindling resources, and an environment that's severely polluted. But we're still the first of the big-time spenders.
Set it apart as a one-of-a-kind motor car, one that would satisfy even the most discriminating taste. Why, the owner is even presented with his or her initials to be mounted right here on the door.